Thank you very much. Thanks to the EAA to invite me for this keynote lecture. Archaeology is an activity whose origin lies in the far distant past. 50,000 years ago, for example, a Neanderthal man or woman carried the fossils back to the Arcy-sur-Cure cave in Burgundy. Much later, Nabonidus, last king of Babylon in the 7th century BC, accidentally stumbled upon the remains of a temple constructed 1,500 years earlier by the famous king Hammurabi in the city of Larsa in present-day Syria. Inspired by the discovery, he had the remains uncovered and restored and left us the following inscription that you hear. I read there the inscription of the ancient king, etc., etc. My heart exulted, holding the big axe, carrying the shovel, transporting the basket. I rebuilt at the end the temple and in the ancient style and decorated this structure for my lords Shamash and Aya. And I restored it on an alabaster tablet. I placed the inscription of the ancient king Hammurabi, which I had read along with my own, and I reinstalled it forever. In one fell swoop, Nabonidus had invented archaeology in all its aspects as the science and language of origin. His description evokes the excitement of the initial discovery, as we normally know as archaeologists, but also the techniques of excavation and restoration, and finally, the manipulation of the past for present ends. While archaeology, this time of the modern sense, really only developed in the Renaissance, it is in part, at its roots, an erudite interest on the part of scholars, princes, and ecclesiastical dignitaries for the glorious antiquity of the Greco-Roman world, which were in the process of being rediscovered at this time. It is this prestigious past that would fill museums, initially private museums, in cities across Europe, that would inspire the first planned archaeological excavation, such as those carried out at Pompeii. Soon after, however, at the end of the 18th century, the notion of nations developed hand in hand with the rise of Romanticism and the French Revolution. Up until this time, kings ruled their subjects under divine rights, that is, by the will of God, and they expanded or reduced their kingdoms through wars and marriages. Now, however, we see the rise of nations, which were seen as communities of citizens animated by a single destiny, sometimes by a single race, and whose origin lay in the mists of time. Archaeology is henceforth vested with a new mission to legitimize this new nation by revealing their glorious past. Thus were constructed what we often term national narratives. While every nation developed its own national narrative, that of France had a particularly unauspicious opening chapter, the defeat at Alesia of the Gauls against the Romans. In March 2012, during the inauguration of the new Chumi design museum designed by the architect Tchoumi at Alésia. The former French prime minister at the time, François Fillon, declared that this was a founding defeat. Alésia was first excavated in the 1860s during the reign of Emperor Napoleon III, who had a grandiose statue of statue of Vercingetorix, the defeated Gaulish leader, erected at the summit of the site. Excavations have been carried out ever since, most recently by a German-French team. As an act of flattery, the sculptor, Aimé Millet, gave the Gaulish hero the features of the emperor, which proved to be an inauspicious choice, since Napoleon III was subsequently defeated at Sedan in 1870 during the French-Prussian War. This defeat led to the establishment of the Second Reich, which was proclaimed in the Galerie des Glaces in the Palace of Versailles in 1871, but also led to the establishment of the Third French Republic. This inaugural defeat at Alésia was in fact just the beginning, since the Roman conquerors were in turn defeated a few centuries later by the Germanic armies under the leadership of the Frankish king Clovis. The Franks, in turn, were destined to disappear culturally within the mass of the conquered Gallo-Romans, leaving only a few Germanic words in our Latin-derived language. This is why, in contrast to all other capital cities, the National Museum, located at the Louvre in the center of Paris, in the Palace of the Kings, houses no objects found on the French soil, but rather objects imported or looted from Italy, Greece, and the Near East, which the French elites of the 19th and 20th centuries so as their true cultural roots. In contrast, the German national narrative opens with a victory, that of the German Arminius over the Roman legions led by Varus in the year 9 AD. This event is illustrated, for example, in the bas-relief frieze that still graces the stairwell of the old National Gallery in Berlin, where the scene is followed by the depiction of the Christianization of the Germans by Saint Boniface and then by Charlemagne. In parallel to the statue of Vercingetorix at Alésia, a gigantic statue of Arminius was erected near Detmold. On the base of this statue is a bronze bas-relief of Kaiser Wilhelm I, fashioned from cannons seized from the French army at Sedan. Furthermore, in parallel with the inauguration of the museum at Alésia, the Varus Schlacht Museum was recently opened in Kalkriza by Chancellor Angela Merkel, here on the slide. However, no mention was made in her speech of a founding victory, but rather it took the form of a call for peace. Getting back to France, there is in fact a National Museum of Archaeology in the Paris area, but it is located in a distant residential suburb at Saint-Germain-en-Laye, and its low profile is matched by the low number of visitors that crosses its threshold, a fact that was recently highlighted by the French Court of Auditors. It has been suggested that it should be moved to the Île de la Cité, in the center of Paris, to a new site facing the Louvre, and that it should even be enlarged to cover the entire history of France. At the moment, the collection comes to an abrupt end at the Merovingians. The Museum of Aquitaine in Bordeaux, for example, presents exactly such a large historical panorama from Paleolithic to now, at least on a regional level, as do museums in many other countries. But in striking confirmation of the national denial, the higher administration of the French Ministry of Culture immediately opposed the suggestion without any political arbitration at a higher level. This explains why the trajectory of rescue archaeology in France diverged from that of many other countries. In fact, up until the 80s, most of the archaeological sites discovered in the course of large-scale development works, such as underground car parks, motorway, high-speed train lines, or quarrying, were more or less abandoned to the bulldozers. However, we know now that in any proposed railway or motorway corridor, for example, one important site will be encountered on average every 1 kilometer. Admittedly, the post-war reconstruction efforts had to prioritize urgent needs and initially focused on providing accommodation and rebuilding the industrial infrastructure. However, by the 60s, the country was once again rich and under the auspice of the Minister of the Culture, André Malraux, the writer, culture was cherished. Great effort was, for example, spent on renovating the historic facade of the capital city. However, it was not until 2001 that a law was voted for the protection of archaeological heritage and which obliged developers to fund rescue excavation prior to large-scale works. It was this law that also created the National Institute for Preventive Archaeology, the INRAP, some 150 years after the creation of the French Archaeological School at Athens that undertook extensive excavation at Delphi, Delos, or Mania in Crete. However, no sooner was this law adopted on January 2001 than it was attacked by the new conservative parliamentary majority, and it has been under attack ever since. The most emblematic measure has been to open the so-called market for this rescue excavation by authorizing the creation of private archaeological companies. More specifically, if the services of the Ministry for Culture deem it necessary to carry out an archaeological excavation prior to a development, it is the developer who chooses the company who will carry out the excavation by putting the various actors in competition. The body selected may be the INRAP, a regional archaeological service, or equally a commercial archaeological company who will generally propose a cheaper and more rapid intervention to the detriment of scientific quality. The service of the Ministry of Culture retains a watchdog status, but starved of resources and personnel, they have difficulty carrying out this role. Furthermore, these private companies can benefit from a significant research tax credit, which allows them to propose a reduced fee. In other words, public money from French citizens is used to help private companies to compete against and sometimes threaten the very existence of public services, that is, INRAP or regional or municipality archaeological services, while at the same time lowering the quality of archaeological excavation and thus the protection of our archaeological heritage. Of course, the granting of this tax credit to commercial companies is subject to the opinion of scientific experts who determine if the company's activities truly constitute scientific research. However, this opinion is purely consultative, and the administrators of the Ministry of Finance, in their ultra-liberal zeal and ideology at the time they were opposed to the setting up of the INRAP, often ignore it and thus subsidize these commercial entities. The Court of Auditors turns a blind eye to this, as does the so-called Competition Authority, Autorité de la Concurrence, a so-called independent body close to the Ministry for Finance. In such instance, the term independent is used, or should we say abused, to qualify a body where all the members are nominated by the government rather than elected by their peers. Nonetheless, because of this commercial price war, several private archaeological companies have already folded, and the largest of them is now in severe financial difficulty. In addition, in France, archaeology tends to be one of the favorite targets of outspoken critics of rules and standards. In 2013, for example, deputies Alain Lambert, a conservative, and Jean-Claude Boulard, a socialist, stated in a report on administrative standards that, as it is written, the abuse of our duty to archaeological memory can sometimes compromise our duty to the future, and that it was important to limit the number of rescue excavations. Also, in October 2014, the government issued a framework of so-called 50 new simplification measures for businesses, which included the so-called measure number 14, adopted under pressure from the public work private sector, and which states somewhat jargonistically, as you can see, that for 2015, when the known nature of the terrain is unlikely to favor the existence of remains, alternative investigation technique, particularly non-destructive surveying, will be employed so as to make diagnostic more rapid. In plain language, this means that that pre-development test trenching using mechanical excavators over 10% of the development site, as it currently the practice, like on the picture, will be a thing of the past, and instead we will have to rely on the so-called non-destructive geophysical prospection. This despite the fact that comparative studies in France, at least, clearly show that 80% of sites discovered through destructive testing actually fail to be detected using such alternative non-destructive techniques. Finally, while nothing has happened as yet, we are all aware of the tenacious persistence of such arguments for the simplification of standards, which can be discerned in the recent French law governing the evolution, the evolution of housing, territorial and digital planning. The law has led, in the case of built heritage, to the suppression of the so-called statement of conformity issued by the architects of Bâtiments de France, who control every building permit, and its replacement by a simple non-constraining recommendation. Everything leads us to fear, in the present context, that there will be further attacks on rescue archaeology in the near future. However, neither the costs nor the delay associated with rescue excavation are prohibitive. There are in fact a myriad of constraints like depollution, water table, geological testing, ecology, that nobody deems unnecessary and that well-organized developers manage to foresee in the overall planning of the works. As regards the costs of archaeological investigation, they are in reality really in excess of 1 to 2% of the total cost of the development and are in any case recouped in the high-speed train tickets, for instance, or tolls on housing prices. Large developers are perfectly aware of this and they now use their participation in archaeological works as an opportunity to self-promotion. Moreover, of the 50,000 hectares of land developed in France every year, or 500 square kilometers, equivalent to an area the size of a French department every decade, only about 50 to 20% are subjected to archaeological testing, and of these, only one case in five results in a real excavation. This means that barely 4% of the developed land surface is actually excavated, and this work generally takes a matter of weeks or at most a few months. Finally, certain fields of daily activity entirely escape archaeological supervision, such as large-scale deforestation and especially agricultural work. Modern agricultural machinery penetrates deep beneath the surface and is capable of gradually reducing ancient walls to dust, as attested by aerial imagery. The silent destruction actually accounts for at least half of the destruction to the archaeological resource, as we have discussed one more time yesterday in our session with Maria Pia Guermandi of the about the Valletta Convention. It would be useful to have equivalent statistics for all European countries showing the areas subject to development works each year and the area that are really investigated archaeologically and actually excavated. These figures exist for certain countries, but are seriously lacking for others. They are, however, vital when attempting to define a real policy regarding rescue excavation, particularly in the context of the European Association of archaeologists. Over the past 30 years, against the official national narrative, and in many parts in Europe, archaeology has, in reality, completely overturned our understanding of the history of the French territory in the other countries, and has destroyed many long-held clichés. Prehistoric people were not savage brutes, but rather lived in equilibrium with the environment and ate healthily. And in fact, we all here in this room too carry within us Neanderthal genes. The invention of agriculture and animal husbandry over a period of millennia often ignored in our school curricula and in our culture, represents the most radical revolution in our history from which sprang, among other things, the demographic explosion, the generalization of violence, and the emergence of the first social hierarchy. The Celts did not live in huts in the middle of the forest, nor did they eat wild boar like Obelix in the Asterix comics, but rather they lived in true towns surrounded by countryside that was more deforested than ours today. And regularly divided into large farms. Late antiquity did not witness an onslaught of blood-crazed barbarians, but instead was a long period of progressive ethnic recomposition and cultural mixing. The Middle Ages were not an age of darkness, but constituted the first industrial revolution, which paved the way for the 19th century industrial revolution. And I could go on. Archaeology is, or could be, for example, an opportunity to reflect on the identity of society and their constant evolution, on migration and continual intermingling, on the collapse of societies and their relationships with the environment, as well as on power and resistance to power. However, all this is struggling to make its way into school curricula, despite the efforts of a number of individual educators and into cultural institutions. There is still in France and in some other European countries a lack of regular archaeological programs on TV channels, in contrast to the situation, for instance, in the UK, Scandinavia, or Japan. There have been plenty of attempts, but they always fall full of the intellectual laziness of the channel directors, who tend to transmit their own disinterest in the subject back to their audience. Compared to Scandinavia, the US or Canada, France, for example, tends to lag behind in the field of museography. But the issue of rescue archaeology is also a general European question. Since 1992, this activity has been regulated by the Malta or Valletta Convention. However, this Malta Convention does not say anything about either the financing of rescue archaeology or about its organization. This is why its organization can vary considerably depending on the various national traditions. At present, depending on the country, two main options emerge. On the one hand, the state is seen as the principal actor, not only in the supervision, but also in the organization of archaeology. On the other, archaeology is seen almost as an economic activity, like any other, which is therefore part of the so-called market economy. These two broad options are also found more generally in the administrative and political structure of Europe. It would seem that the best option of all would be to provide Europe with large common public services by fusing the various national public services so as to create, for example, a single European postal system, a single public transport system, a single power supply service, a single health insurance system, etc. The chosen second option is practically the opposite. We have opted to progressively eliminate the public services of each European nation and to hand them over to the competitive private sector, the so-called free and fair competition in the Brussels newspeak. A process which is more advanced in some countries than in others. Consequently, we should have a multitude of competitive private companies, each with the possibility of working anywhere within the European economic space. In the first case, we are dealing with public services whose only reason for being is to serve the public interest. In the second case, we are dealing with private companies whose only reason for being is to make a profit, but who, in making this profit, are supposed to offer the best possible service to the consumer on condition that this consumer really has all objective information at his disposal. The first model belongs to the social democratic political tradition, or to a watered-down version which is sometimes known as the Rhineland capitalism. The second model belongs to the British and American tradition of economic liberalism or ultra-liberalism, which was particularly developed under the leaderships of Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher. Surprisingly, the citizens of Europe have never benefited from an open political debate on the essential question of what type of society should be selected, and in practice, it is the liberal model that has come to the fore in common European policy. Admittedly, the pressure exerted by the liberal economic model is not just a European issue. In fact, this pressure, which originates from the US, is applied through international bodies such as the World Trade Organization, the International Monetary Fund, or the World Bank, among others. In the case of archaeology, the results of privatization has been pretty negative in many European countries, at least. As we have witnessed in France, there is a decline in quality and working conditions. Scientific documentation becomes dispersed, and level of recording vary greatly depending on the company and sites involved, and also against the working condition of the archaeologist on the field. Outside Europe, this trend is even more marked in the United States, where some companies have a reputation for never finding archaeological sites during testing operation carried out for developers. In contrast, in Japan, an industrial country that devotes more time and resources to archaeology, about 1 billion euro and 60,000 professional archaeologists, archaeology was for a long time largely a public service administered by local governments, and there were practically no private companies until the ultra-liberal policies introduced by the present government. When we speak of the current crisis in Europe, or more, not only economic, but political, societal, and cultural, or more precisely in the EU, we might ask ourselves if this vision, which is ultimately philosophical, of a society where everything is subject to competition might not actually be the deep-rooted and the most serious cause of this crisis. Instead of solidarity between citizens, we have in fact been promised the conditions of war of everyone against everyone, as described by the English philosopher Thomas Hobbes in the 17th century. It should be noted that while the EU has taken numerous initiatives in order to create a large financial and economic market, the common currency, increased commercial competition and privatization of public services, it has done precious little in other essential areas such as taxation, pensions, social rights, labor laws, education, or culture. Admittedly, it does award the title of European City of Culture to two European cities per year and has proclaimed this year European Year of Cultural Heritage. It has also attempted to unify European university system through the so-called Bologna process of 1999 by adopting the system prevailing in the English-speaking world. A large part of the disillusion currently felt by citizens of the EU is not due to immigration, an issue that has been manipulated by the far right in several countries, including France, Italy, Germany, and several Central European countries. Instead, it springs from this marked contrast between constraining commercial and financial rules and the complete lack of ambition in the social, political, and cultural domains. In this wider context, the problem of archaeology is only a symptom of much more serious and worrying ills. Moreover, as regards archaeology, European rules are so vague that regression has been possible, as we have recently seen in Hungary, where a new law greatly limits the time and budget allocated to rescue archaeology. And it should be the real duty and responsibility of the EAA to denounce such regulations. It should be added that the situation of rescue archaeology in Europe is far from being the worst in an international scale. The situation in the less developed country is much more worrying. There are only a few dozen archaeologists employed on the entire African continent, which is three times larger than geographical Europe and six times larger than the EU, which has between 25,000 and 30,000 archaeologists. Even China, which is a highly organized state, has only 2,000 professional archaeologists for an area similar to that of geographical Europe. It is significant that while there are UNESCO conventions governing diverse subjects, there is nothing dealing with rescue archaeology, with the exception of the very old recommendation on international principles applicable to archaeological excavation issued in New Delhi in 1956, which is, as its title indicates, is simply a non-binding recommendation which has had little actual influence. Under the auspices of UNESCO, however, a number of decisions have been made which highlight the interest taken by states in archaeological heritage. In Venice, in 1964, the International Charter for the Conservation and Restoration, etc., was signed, which is in turn led to the creation of the International Council on Monuments and Sites, or ICOMOS, in Warsaw in 1965. Still within the framework of UNESCO, 1964 saw the launch of the Mammoth Campaign to save the temple in Nubia and Egypt, which were threatened by the rising waters of Lake Nasser following the construction of the Aswan Dam. A certain number of countries took part in the campaign, and it is paradoxical that 50 years later, such large-scale international rescue operations have never been repeated since. The large dams erected on the Euphrates River in the 1990s, for instance, submerged thousands of archaeological sites without any large-scale intervention in Syria and in Turkey. The ancient Greek city of Zeugma in Turkey underwent only were summary and insufficient rescue excavations, which were undertaken in very difficult conditions by international teams. The early 70s saw the Convention on the Means of Prohibiting and Preventing the Illicit Import, etc., which was signed in Paris in 70, and the Convention Concerning the Protection of the World Cultural and Natural Heritage, also signed in Paris in 72. The letter gave rise exactly 40 years ago to the World Heritage Center, which has since drawn up a list of almost 1,000 archaeological sites throughout the world, which are considered to be of global significance to humanity. Some of these sites, such as Angkor in Cambodia, have been included in a separate list, namely the list of World Heritage in Danger. The prehistoric Lascaux Cave in France was recently considered for inclusion on this list. In any case, inclusion on the list does not mean that a site will receive UNESCO financial aid, since the organization itself had relatively limited funds. Instead, the list is intended to encourage each country concerned to better protect the sites included. it should also be mentioned that the 1,000 sites on the list are all high-profile, prestigious sites. Without exaggeration, if we extrapolate from the statistics I quoted earlier for France, it is likely that up to 1,000 archaeological sites are destroyed in the world every day due to development work, and this destruction occurs without the benefit of rescue excavation. This is why archaeologists can't remain in these scholarly ivory towers, but must also be responsible actors in the protection of archaeological heritage, not only in their own countries, but on an international level also. They must also be responsible for ensuring that the past is not manipulated for the benefit of reprehensible ideology. I don't wish to end on a pessimistic note. In recent years, archaeological research has continued to contribute significantly to our understanding of Europe's past, as we have seen here in the AIA during all these four days. Even though archaeological heritage is by definition non-renewable, rescue archaeology has allowed us to preserve numerous sites, at least through documentation. Furthermore, the method of techniques used in archaeological investigation are constantly evolving. For example, the application of laser or LIDAR prospection allows us to discover sites in mountainous and forested areas. Physico-chemical analysis tells us more and more about the composition and circulation of raw material. Strontium analysis allows us to identify migration. Genetics, not only through light of family relationships, but also helps us to understand the movements of individuals or entire population, even though we must be careful not to commit the same error of 19th century physical anthropologists, which equated people with race in what is sometimes known as the Kosinian model. Genetic results concerning the Bell Digger culture published this year clearly show that there is no correlation between genetic heritage and material culture, and several sessions was also discussing these points in the present conference. If we want to go further, it is clear that in the face of this issue, the European Association of Archaeologists must play a fundamental and concrete role in the future, particularly by clarifying certain points of the Malta Convention. Thank you for attention.